Hello, I'm Jessica Cowgren-Hayes, and welcome to Filmfest on TV, your weekly nationally broadcast film festival. Coming up on today's show, a variety of short films from Camelot Films, headed by twin brothers Liam and Kyle Bashford. The twins began their directing career at the age of 17, and since that time have earned multiple awards for their short films. Operating out of Pinewood Studios, their recent films have secured worldwide distribution, including 2013's Smile, which was brought at the 66th Cannes International Film Festival. Their short film, Perfect Match, was selected at the London Sci-Fi 48-Hour Film Challenge, being shown to industry professionals, including Danny Boyle. Most recently, they directed the moving film Then and Now, starring Julian Glover of Game of Thrones and James Bond fame, which we'll be finding out a little more about at the end of the show. Remember, if you too would like to get involved and have films to share, then email me, Jessica Cowgren-Hayes, via jessica@thelatest.tv. We're now joined by Matt Hookings, an actor and writer who works closely with the twins, to discuss his film, Oh. So Matt, thank you very much for joining us and coming on to talk about the show. Now, can you tell me how you got started in the world of film?
So I started as an actor, very young, in school plays. I went on to study drama at university and then moved to London, pursued the career from there, and then I kind of fell into filmmaking and producing and combining the two together, I suppose.
But you also write some films, so what's your kind of background there? Are you always scribbling down stories as a child?
I don't know, I have a lot of ideas, and I think it was just about putting them on paper. And a lot of the stuff that I was doing, I just thought I could do a better job, or I could put something down that was you know, I had control over, or I could play the character that I wanted to play. So I suppose that the freedom in that was quite interesting.
Do you find it much easier to act and work you've already written?
Sometimes you get too close to it, which I think is a good and bad thing. Mm. So sometimes it's nice to read something that's fresh that you haven't written or had an involvement in, but the aspect of having more control, or the idea of, you know, understanding the character or the story more because you've had a direct involvement in it, that helps. So it's vice versa, I think.
So then the first film of yours that we're going to show this evening is O, which I believe you acted in and produced.
Yes.
As well.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about how that film came to be?
O was quite interesting because we'd done a few films before, but we wanted to do this one properly, so we kind of set up everything. We got the locations, we wanted to get new directors, we wanted to kind of develop an idea but then give it to someone else to kind of bring their own to it. So that's how that kind of developed, and it was just something, it started out as like a conversation thing between a group of friends in a pub, and it just kind of grew from there, and then we were linking it to London and
so
other aspects.
The idea is that if a group of friends in a pub, it's the end of the world, everything's ending, and it goes a little bit, well, I say a little bit, it goes quite out of control.
Yeah, it goes pretty dark, which we never sensed that. The directors, the twins, they brought that into the film, which was great.
Ah.
So, so those elements as well were added to it, which was great.
What was the best part of shooting?
Best part of shooting, I don't know. I think the others would probably say the scenes in the warehouse, because we shot in a warehouse, a huge warehouse, and made it look like a riot outside, which was super fun. But I enjoyed the pub stuff just because it was really dark and it was really enclosed and just gritty, and I don't know, it was just a nice atmosphere, I suppose.
Fabulous. Well, let's have a look at O. That was O from Camelot Films, directed by the Bashford twins, who we're going to be talking to you a little later on. Now, Matt, you're still with us, and we're going to talk about the film that we're going to show after the break, Shoe Polish, which you wrote.
Yes.
And I understand was also filmed in the same warehouse as the crowd scene in O.
Yes. It was quite an interesting aspect, and we had to change a lot around, because in O it's very dark and there's people crammed together, and it's very, everything's moving quite quickly within a sort of caged setup, whereas Shoe Polish is very open and you see the sort of vast space of the warehouse. So there is, and the light and things are different, so it is different. You don't expect people to sort of pick it up and see that it's the same place, but it's quite interesting.
Now in Shoe Polish we've got a gangster and police. And what was your inspiration for that?
I really like the film noir genre, especially from the 40s, 50s, even some in the 60s. So that kind of is where the inspiration came from. And I like the idea that if something's happening somewhere else, something else can be happening in a different place, but equally at the same time. So the locations are different. It's in the warehouse, it's out the warehouse, it's on top of the warehouse. But they're all happening at the same time, simultaneously. Mm. So the story kind of interlocks in that sense. But yeah, you know, just gangster and using a few guns is quite cool sometimes and blowing off some steam.
How do you find casting your actors for a piece that you've written?
A lot of it is normally friends or people that I know and trust. With Shoe Polish, we pulled in Michael McKellen and Ian Burfield, which are both recognisable faces. So that helped, just because it was something that they were used to in terms of, you know, being able to pull off the cop or the gangster. So I don't know. And then it's just, you know, being an actor, you know so many other actors. So
yes.
You're kind of spoiled for choice. It's about who fits the part the best, and also then, I don't know, kind of who's best to work with.
So tune in after the break for Shoe Polish. So that was Shoe Polish. Now, tell me, how did you start working with the Bashford twins?
So we met the twins on O, which was the first film.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, just worked with them ever since. Live with them now as well, so it's quite interesting because we kind of work and live together, which is...
It's a good dynamic.
Yeah.
24 hours a day together.
Yeah. Yeah, we just clicked. It was just one of those things where they direct, they do their thing. You know, I'll help with the producer and everything beforehand. Mm. And then when we shoot, they do their thing and I do my thing. And then it kind of... And we pull in together at the end and then just do it that way, I suppose.
But having worked with other directors, how do you find their style?
I think they're just really easy to work with. They're very talented, and they're easygoing. If there's a problem or an issue or anything that you want to address, you can just do that quite easily, whereas other directors can be quite standoffish. They'd be very specific or particular what they want. And sometimes it's great because they have a vision and they know what they want, but, you know, the end product is the kind of thing. If the film that they're putting out isn't good or the acting's off or all that kind of stuff, then that's where you want to work with the actors or the producers or whatever just during that time because you can't sort it out afterwards.
Yeah.
So
they're not too stuck in the auteur theory of the vision.
Yeah.
Not open to having suggestions from others.
Exactly, yeah. And I think it's a lot of it's about ego and different things like that because they, like I said, I can say, look, do you want me to try this or do you want me to try that? And it might not be right, but at least I've tried it and then they're comfortable with that and you never know what comes out. A lot of... You know, his stories about a lot of the great films, a lot of it's organic or, you know, improvised, all that kind of stuff. So that's kind of how it works, I suppose.
Now, we're about to show a film of theirs, Smile.
Yes.
Which is one of their first films.
Yes.
Could you tell me how they started a little bit in filmmaking?
Yeah, I mean, I think they had a similar story to myself in terms of they didn't want to sit around and wait for someone to call them for a job. They wanted to get up and kind of make their own films and get out there and, you know, have control in what they do and all that kind of stuff. So I think it's having that artistic control, but, you know, being good at what you do as well. So
that's sort of what you'd advise any young person wanting to get into the film industry, whether it be filmmaking or acting, to actually just get out there, start shooting.
Yeah, just literally start doing it. So I did so much stuff before where I just picked up a camera and started recording, and you learn something new every time, so that's the that's the real benefit of it. And I think the more experience you have, you know, you can work in different environments and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, it's definitely that instead of sort of waiting around and just, I don't know, waiting for your agent to call or something.
And of course the great thing nowadays is that we've all got cameras.
Yes. Yeah.
Got them on our phones, we can be recording each other.
Yeah, that's it.
Making,
you know,
films.
You can just pick up an iPhone now and or a Samson or whatever and go and shoot a film, basically. But I always say, you know, have a good story first and get that right, and then everything else can follow.
Story is the most important.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, so we're now going to go and see Smile, and then when we come back, we'll have an interview with the Bashford twins. So hello, chaps. Thank you very much for joining us on the show.
It's all right.
Now, we've just seen Smile, one of your very first films. Mm. Can you tell us a little bit about how you got started in film?
I think it was when we were in secondary school. We're both always interested in writing, like coming up with creative sort of wacky ideas, like Goosebumps, that kind of inspired us to sort of go into our imagination. So that's kind of how the writing started, and the directing just came with just getting a handy cam from our parents and just going from there.
Yeah, I think we were about 14 when our mum and dad got a handy cam.
Ah.
We just loved just filming around the garden or in the house and just doing some short little films and stuff. So that's kind of where the whole thing started. And we directed a World War II documentary when we were about 17. So that's kind of when the directing started as well.
Is that the sort of age that you decided, this is what we're going to do, we're going to focus just on filmmaking, make this our career?
Yeah, it was instantly, like, as soon as we did the World War II, we just kind of like, we both really loved doing that and we just want to keep going and keep creating just our own kind of ideas. Mm. So that's kind of like what we've been doing so far.
And obviously it's gone very well for you.
Yeah.
You've won quite a few awards.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that.
The recent film Then and Now has picked up 5 awards so far. The very first award was for Best Director when I think we were about 19, which was a film called In the Mirror. And we did that ourselves and it was like a 2-minute horror film. So that was really good when that we won the first
one. How do you find it working together as co-directors? I imagine as twins, it's a bit easier than it would be for anyone else.
Yeah, it's literally just one person, two bodies. It's just
that's
it's
so sweet.
It's like I couldn't personally just like if I had like a problem, I could go to Kyle. If he did, then he would come to me. But I think it's more of an experience for the actors. They for some reason they just love like a new experience with twin directors, so that's nice to hear.
There's never any friction. Someone has an idea, the other person doesn't like it.
We're always on the same wavelength. Like it's weird. Like I would think of an idea, and Liam would come to me and say the exact same idea. So we are always on the same wavelength. There's no friction at all.
Fabulous.
So, yeah.
Well, when we come back from the break, we're going to talk about the next Bashford Twins movie that we're going to be showing, which is Perfect Match. Welcome back to Filmfest on TV. I'm still with the Bashford Twins, who are going to tell us a little bit about their film, Perfect Match.
Yeah. This one was a 48-hour challenge, this one. So we made that all in 48 hours, which was a challenge. And we didn't get any sleep for 44 hours. Like, we literally just got up, got all the guidelines that we had to get, and then just literally just shot, edited everything. So, yes.
Can you tell us a bit about the film?
Yeah, it's a psychological sci-fi drama. About a guy who can't find his perfect woman in the real world. So he goes onto this online sort of dating program just to create his perfect woman.
And of course, things don't go entirely to plan.
No,
as they never do. So was this quite, you say it was a challenge, but was it an immediate idea that you came up with, or did you really have to sit and think?
We had like a concept, but you just never know what they're going to give you. They give you prop ideas, the title of the film, just things like that, and you have to kind of be quite quick to sort of think of ideas and get the right actors as well.
Mm-hmm. We're very pleased how the film turned out.
Yeah.
It's a great film, a really good idea.
You like it?
Yeah, thanks.
Really like it. Yeah, a lot of people really like it. I think it's because you connect with it more. A lot of people can kind of, I don't know, they can relate to it. So I think that's, I think it's the story as well, which is what we're more passionate about. It's more about the story.
Yeah, can relate to the idea of looking for love and the idea of perfection.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Was it quite easy to shoot?
Because we only had two actors and it was one location pretty much. We used to live on a farm, so although it was in one location, we could shoot it so it looked like it was different locations, and so that was good time wise.
Mm. Well, you did a really great job. So let's have a look at Perfect Match. That was Perfect Match. Now, the next film of yours we're going to show, $3 Million Milkshake, I believe, is going to be filmed in Brighton.
Yeah, it was the original idea, because we're actually having a milkshake in London, and we saw all these, like, the neon signs. It just looked like an amazing place, and we just thought, what if we could do, like, a gangster kind of film inside a diner. So
that's kind of like where it came from, because the whole milkshake idea, but it was like, where can we involve this milkshake? Then through time, it was like, that's hide the diamonds in the milkshake. Mm-hmm. So that's where the idea all came from. And we love that genre as well. Mm.
And your lead actress is from Brighton.
Yeah, that's why we wanted to shoot it in Brighton, but for the budget, it would cost like maybe 5,000-10,000 more to get the whole crew to Brighton, to let them stay over, and to obviously hire the diner as well, which they were asking way too much. So we decided to shoot it in like a bar instead.
Yeah. Well, it's such an important thing when you're creating a short film to think about your budget.
Yeah.
Especially since after short films have been completed, they're not so commercial, you can't necessarily sell them to a lot of places.
No.
How have you found showing your short films?
It's been, do you mean in terms of locations, finding the locations, or...?
In terms of once they're completed.
When they're complete, it's usually festivals. You've just got to send it to as many festivals as you can. It's a lot of money, but you've just got to get yourself out there. You're not going to get money from it, but the exposure is worth more than money. So that's the best way to get yourself out there.
Thank you for that advice.
That's all.
Hello and welcome back to Film Fest on TV. We're now joined by all of the chaps from Camelot to tell us about their new film, Then and Now. But first, let's see the trailer. Looks to be a great film.
Thanks.
So what can you tell us about it?
Well, the story came from Matt to start with, but the whole story is about George, who wakes up and watches 9/11 terrorist attacks. And it's quite an emotional film because he's lost a loved one through that as well. So it goes through his journey on that process as well.
Mm. How is it to make the film?
To make the film, it seemed like it was quite hard at first, just because it was just the three of us.
Mm.
We were trying to find the money to make it. We're all broke, so we were just basically living off beans and spaghetti. So it was hard at first, but like the whole process of filmmaking is so enjoyable that like. At the end of the day, it's what we love to do.
Do it for peanuts.
Yeah.
Do it for the love.
I think the great thing about this is we're all very much involved in this one.
Yeah.
You know, we went to pick up the lighting equipment, we scheduled everything, we planned everything, and we really wanted a named actor fall apart, just to have that presence. So even going and getting that was quite challenging. But the aspects of filming, because it's all set in one location, looks less ambitious, but obviously the challenges are still there.
So since the film was completed, you've been showing it at various places. What sort of reception have you had?
Very good.
Yeah, amazing response, especially in America. We
we wanted to do like a British perspective, and we're just really happy that the Americans have come across so positively. We won two awards in New York, and we're showing the film in, is it Charleston?
Charleston. We showed it at Rhode Island, which is Oscar qualifying, and we're screening it on September 11th at 7 p.m. I think, just off the coast of New York, in Northeast Film Festival. So that's quite an achievement, I think, for
Very impressive. Yeah. Very good. And people watching our show who'd like to go and see the film, when will they be able to see it? Where should they go?
Well, the next one is in Henley Film Festival, which is this Sunday. And I think that's
Manchester. We've got somewhere in Manchester then.
I think Manchester in November.
Yeah.
So at the moment they're the only two British ones.
A variety.
Yeah. We have got a screening, I think, almost every month, but it's just different places.
Yeah.
We're screening in Kosovo as well, which. Yeah.
So I would advise people following you on Twitter to follow you around the country.
Yeah.
Work out where you're going to be next.
Serbia, I think. So it's. Yeah, we're very proud of it, so we're getting out there as much as
good.
We can.
Good. Now, we're about to show a music video that's all about then and now, but could you tell us just a little bit about what you're going on to next?
Yeah.
We're working on a feature film called Prizefighter, which is a period drama about a bare-knuckle boxer from the 1700s. So we're all kind of working on that together, getting that in development. So, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. Been working on that for quite a while now. It's been quite a passion project for us as well, and living together as well. We're literally on it every day, so.
Don't get a break from each other.
No.
Never.
No. don't get sick of each other, so it's fine.
We've done it. A break.
Yeah.
So, what are the challenges moving from short films to much longer films?
It's completely different.
Yeah.
It's just everything's tenfold that you got to, and to we've always done the shorts on a very small budget. But this, it's to have that feel and the look you want for it, it's got to be done properly, and you need, you need everything. You need, more people to help out and everything.
Yeah, it sounds like more work, but you've got more people to help you, so it will be more work, but you've got other people surrounded to help you, so that's the good thing about moving into features.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
Well, chaps, thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Sorry.
And for people who want to follow you, follow your work, where would you advise they go?
Yeah, we're on Twitter, Camelot Films. Instagram, obviously you can find myself, Matt Hookins.
If you go on Instagram, you can search for at Bashford Twins, Twitter, Instagram.
So Bashford Twins or bashfordtwins.com. Yeah.
Social media, you're out there.
Yeah.
If you go on Camelot, all our links are on there. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for joining us. Let's have a little look at the music video for Then and Now. Thank you for watching tonight's show. I hope you've enjoyed it. If you've missed any part, then please check our Facebook page, FilmFest on TV, for catch-up options. If you'd like to join the conversation, then tweet us at FilmFest on TV or use the hashtag FilmFest on TV. Thanks to Matt Hookings, Liam Bashford and Carl Bashford from Camelot Films. If you're a filmmaker and would like to see your work featured on FilmFest, then get in touch with me, Jessica Kerrigan-Hayes, by Jessica at thelatest.tv. And I'll see you next week.